Okay, welcome guys. Much for joining today. I'm gonna keep this very, very simple and easy. Something which a topic which I got to read up and do a presentation on recently with another client, and I felt this has a lot of deeper connect with what we do as work. So I told Rajat that this would be one topic that I would like to do as a webinar sometime, and we got an opportunity, so here I am. So happy to see all of you again. Big group of people, and I know some more people have already messaged me saying they kind of caught up with few things, but no problem. They said they'll be joining in between anyway, so let's move on. This is a very, as I said, it's a very simple and easy topic. So I want you guys to completely relax and enjoy the whole thing. One request I would actually have is if you can somehow find a pen and paper for this, that'll be great. Or if you want to just use your mobile phone, that's also fine with me. You know, just to type in. But it'll be nice to have a pen and paper with you, because I have a few small activities which I thought that can make a big difference. Okay, so this is what I got. I mean, I did as a program. The mind shift using unlearning and overwriting. Okay, what does this all mean to us, and how we can really make a difference with this? The background is I had done this for for an education school for teachers, but then I felt this would be a great opportunity, because this is something which you can do as a practice, and that practice can make a big difference to what we do as coaching. So there it makes a big difference. By any chance, have any of you gone through unlearning or unlearning process or anything like that before? You can just ping or raise your hands or just nod your head. That should be okay. All right. Great. Okay. So let me move on. This is what we're going to do today. Meaning and importance of what unlearning and overwriting is. Why do we need to unlearn and overwrite? Let's talk about that. Why you? Okay. Why are you guys here to kind of go over this? That's another thing. And a small technique which I kind of came up with respect to how we can unlearn and overwrite. So these are the things that I wanted to kind of share with you today. All right. Okay. So. Okay, so this is the unlearning process. I'm going to show you a slide, and I'm going to give you 1 minute for you to understand the entire process. There's going to be a process which I'm going to show you right now. I'm just giving you 1 minute exactly for you to understand the process, and just write down the top 3 points that you took away from it. Okay, exactly 1 minute. Sure. Yeah, you can, as I said, you can use your mobile phone also.
Arvind, can you repeat that?
This is the unlearning. What I'm going to show you right now, there's going to be a picture coming up about a process of unlearning. Okay. And you just have to study that. But I'm going to give you just a minute for you to go through that entire picture and take away two things. Take away top two things for yourself. All right. I'll start right now. Go ahead. Take away whatever you want from this slide. 20 seconds. Okay, stop. Okay, just write down top two things that you have kind of taken away from it. Okay, just write down whatever that you've taken away. Two things. That is the unlearning process, guys. Okay, more or less, I have told you what the unlearning process is. So you've learned unlearning right now. That's the process. So just note down two points, top two points for you. Done? Okay, so let's look at the meaning of what unlearning means, okay? Unlearning is basically that when you discard something from your memory, okay? That's what unlearning means. And what you discard is something that you've learned, either it's a bad habit or a false or an outdated information. False or an outdated information. When you let go of that, that's where unlearning actually happens. Okay. So let's see what overwrite means. Overwrite is very simple. Write on top of another thing. Simple. Fair enough? Okay. Now, in a very large, I read about a lot of definitions around this, but this is what something that I really liked. So unlearning is an ever-changing fluid process of exploration, okay, by using different sets of questions about everything we know and value to discover unknowns. This is what unlearning is. That's a definition. Just absorb whatever you can. Don't worry about it. Overwrite is where the questions have created new answers. And you will override the new understanding over the old one. Simple? Fair enough? In fact, this should kind of trigger some thoughts already with you guys. With respect to what you guys do as coaches, or even in the way you learned the whole coaching program, these are some of the things that was automatically happening for you. Right? Moving on. I'll just give you a small importance of what, so Alvin Toffler is one of the very famous educationists. He wrote this two books called Third Wave and Future Shock. Yes, Dr. Rudra.
Are we allowed to ask questions while you are running, or do we need to wait till the end?
I would suggest if you could wait till the end.
Okay, sure. Thank you.
Sure. Okay, so Alvin Toffler is one of the very famous educationists. In fact, he has done a huge research on how learning needs to completely change, specifically at the education level, and what needs to actually happen. So he's done a lot of work, and he wrote these two books called Third Wave and Future Shock, which really, he has predicted certain things about how our learning is going to change in the future. Very nice books. I haven't fully read them, but I've heard a lot about those books. In that, he has actually quoted this. Okay. Tomorrow's illiterate will not be the man who can't read. He will be the man who has not learned how to unlearn. Okay. And this is what, in a way, all of us are in this journey of creating unlearning for others. And that's why I brought this importance across to you guys today. So that you know that why we need to really get into this topic right now. So I was already saying this. Why unlearn or override? Basically, letting go is unlearning. Okay. Tell me how true this statement is. You can type about this in the chat if you want. Right. So we want there is always this belief running with us, and that's exactly why we feel that it's always others who has to actually change, right? But there is a lot of unlearning that we have to do within ourselves, and that's where your letting go actually happens. So here is a quick activity for you guys. Okay. Why is this happening? One second. Yeah. So just note this down. Think of three things that annoy you or upset you. You can write it as a word or as a sentence, anything you want. Think of three things that annoy you or upset you. Okay. Now, while you have written that down, okay, just at the end of that sentence, can you write, or if you're using your mobile phone, can you just type it out at the end, saying for all the three things that you've written? So what? Just write that down. And try to say that to yourself. The three things that annoy you or upsetting you, it has been annoying and upsetting you for some time, but now you're adding a small question at the end saying, so what? Okay. Now, the minute you say, so what, there is something else happening with you right now, at this moment. Right? You're able to see something beyond what you actually wrote as this is what is annoying me, right? So can you just write that down now? It could be a word, it could be a sentence, it could be a feeling, it could be anything. Don't worry about that. But whatever is becoming possible to you, when you say, so what, write that down. Okay. Now, remove the so what and replace it with and now. There are two things that you've received right now. You were annoyed about something. You asked a question. Something became possible and you've written that down. Just remove the so what and rewrite that entire sentence with and now. Try to now read it for yourself, the three sentences with and now, and just be with whatever experience you have right now, whatever the feeling that you have right now with that. Okay. I'm calling this as an experience of a release. You are or not something, there is something that you're stuck with, but you are able to do something about it and recreate the whole thing. So you, according to me, you're kind of experiencing a release of whatever you were stuck with. Would that be a fair thing for me to say? And you can do this with anything that you feel stuck about. You can just write that down and add these two concepts, and that whole release actually happens. So, very interestingly, a simple concept, which there is a learning that you have about what you're annoyed, okay? But by asking a question and receiving an answer, which is exactly what we read about from a definition perspective, you have now overwritten something that you know or something that you think which annoys you. There is an unlearning that's actually happened, and there is also an overwriting that's actually happening. Would that be fair for me to say that? A simple concept, nothing major. I'm just trying to see if I can create that experience of what an unlearning and overwriting is for you guys today. So if you actually see, there are things that we have done over a long period of time about many things that we have unlearned and we have overwritten on top of it. In fact, while you did this exercise, there might have things that might have got popped up from your past on things that you might have unlearned and overwritten. Would that be correct for me to say that? Right? So here is an additional ask from you. Think of two things that you have already unlearned or overwritten from your life. It could be anything, from the basic level of when you were a kid to, you know, something that you might have unlearned as early as last week. And you might have overwritten on top of it. So think of those two things and see if you want to write them down. I'm absolutely okay for you to write them down. Okay, so basically, guys, what I attempted today was to see if in a simple conversation, there are things that we can unlearn and we have the capacity to override. And if you as coaches can experience it, okay, you can definitely recreate this with the people whom you're actually having conversations with. I'm not even calling them as clients because I know you guys are talking to very many different people, but there is always a possibility for them to now unlearn and overwrite on things that, and that's where the whole concept of habit and all of that comes in, right? So this was one small attempt from my side, which I felt that will create that. Okay. I'll stop here. I will open up for questions if there is anything. If there is anything. I saw a note from Dr. Rudra saying not fair. I didn't understand what that meant. So Dr. Rudra, would you want to share that?
Arvind, he has dropped.
Oh, he's dropped. Okay. I was not able to see. Okay. Anybody else has questions? Anything that's coming up? Anything you want to share at this moment? Okay. Interesting. All right. So if there is anything coming up, do let me know. Right. So you've now understand why unlearn and overwrite or overwrite and how do you do it? Is that pretty, you know, just a small attempt, and you can actually use this as an exercise for yourself too. I mean, that's open to you. In fact, the question called so what can be changed into any other word. You don't have to use the word what, the question what. You can just say so. And that can create something new.
Yeah.
Or why, right? Any question you can actually alter it to. But whenever we feel stuck about something, there is always a question that can really create a release. And that's what we saw in the earlier definition of what an... It creates a set of questions. There is an exploration that actually happens. And once that exploration happens, there are answers. The new answer is what you're actually overwriting on top.
Hey, Arvind. So,
yes, Mejan.
So the so what part was clear, and actually it was very useful for me also.
Okay.
In at least 2 out of 3 cases.
Okay.
The and now part actually I didn't get. I mean, do you have an example of an and now? I wasn't able to follow what happens with the and now.
Okay. So can you, would it be okay to share what you have written?
Yeah. Yeah. So for example, you know, one thing that drives me crazy is, you know, when somebody starts honking behind me when there's no place in front of me to go. Okay.
Okay. Okay.
So I suddenly ask myself, so what? And well, my so what answer gave me an answer that says that's extremely disrespectful, rude behavior on that person's part, for example. Right.
Okay.
And that is what drives me crazy. Right. But in general, I mean, it worked for me. The so what part worked, that says, you know, what's the big deal, right? What the heck?
Mm.
Doesn't matter. So it had that sense of release for me, right?
Got that. Okay.
But then the and now, I couldn't figure out. So what am I supposed to think about, you know, in an and now?
No, you're just replacing so what. So just say the same thing again. If you have to just share it as a sentence, can you just share that?
So, you know, people honking behind me when there is no place for me.
Okay.
Is, you know, annoying and irritating and drives me crazy.
Right.
So, and now? I don't know.
No, and now whatever you said after when you wrote so what, you got something right after so what.
Yeah. So what I was.
It's not a big deal. It's not a.
Correct. Yes. Yeah.
So just put that sentence together. That's all.
Hmm.
People honking behind me comes to me.
Yeah. So what?
And now what's the big deal?
Yeah. What's the big deal? Well, people, you know, what occurs to me is that, you know, people will be as they will be. You can't change them. So what, right? You can't change them.
Right.
There's no point wasting my time, energy in trying to change everybody on the road.
Yes.
Right?
Yes.
And now, I think I would just pull over and let the guy pass. I don't know. At best,
right. Absolutely. What I'm saying is, you're no more in that locked situation of your feeling of annoyed.
Mm-hmm.
The lock has released. There is an unlock that has actually happened. That's all I'm trying to drive here.
Mm-hmm.
So what is my thought process? The so what can be anything for you.
Yeah,
but the question is key.
Your
system is locked. You're using a question as a key to unlock.
Mm.
And there is something opening up. And the opening up becomes the overwriting factor for you.
Yes. Yeah.
Right? And that's what now you're going to override. So every time you have now somebody honking behind you, you can actually say, okay, I'm going to pull over.
At
least I don't have to feel annoyed anymore.
Yeah,
because they are going to continue doing that. Right. And that's where that whole concept of the example which I've given, the belief that someone else is responsible for our own happiness leads us to expect them to change.
Oh yeah, that's a perfect example actually. Yeah.
Right.
Now that you tie it back into that, yeah, that's perfect. Yeah. I mean, I'm sure I can't change that person's honking habit.
Correct. Right?
And even if I could one, then there are anyway a million people that I can't change. So.
Yes. Yes. But you can. You have that capacity. You can unlearn and you can override.
Hmm. Yeah. Yeah.
That power is always there with you.
Yeah. Right. So when you say the so what, I mean, clearly the answer should be one that leads you to, yeah, it's not really a big deal, right? Or it's not something that should bother you that much, for example.
Right. And, yeah. No, okay. And at every moment, Mejan, at every moment, at every stage, if you ask the so what question, you will have a different answer coming out.
Okay.
That answer will depend on that environment where you are in and what's really happening today in this environment of you sitting here at this moment. You got this answer.
Mm-hmm.
When you're actually sitting in the car and when you hear the honking behind, at that time, if you actually have to ask the same question, this guy is annoying me, so what? And then something will happen for you.
Yeah, yeah. I mean, but I really like the way you connected it to that earlier statement of yours, you know, the belief of, you know, other people are responsible for my happiness. I think if we ask the so what question in that context,
right,
that is very powerful. I mean, I thought, yeah, that was interesting. I just looked at it isolated. I didn't look at your belief thing above that when I was asking
got
the
it.
So what.
Got it. Oh, got it.
Thanks. That's clear.
Thanks, Prashant. Thank you. Thanks, Prashant. Any other questions, guys? Anything else? Okay. Yeah. So why you? Okay. Why are you the people involved in this? And as you all know that I have a lot of movie related influences, I thought I'll bring in again two examples which I felt very powerful with respect to why you. Why you is one. In fact, there is why me also. All of us are in the path of making a difference to somebody else's life. There is something that we are actually going to be doing while we are actually having conversations with another person, right? So you hold a big responsibility. I don't want to call it under the word called coach here, because every one of you is playing a different role at different times. So I would want to keep all the open. It could be you as a father. It could be you as a mentor. It could be you as a leader somewhere. It could be you as a husband somewhere, or a or a spouse somewhere, for anything for that matter. I leave that whole concept across to you. But the movie influence of how this works is, I'm taking one first movie, which is Taare Zameen Par. I hope some of you have seen it, or most of you have seen it.
Yes.
Okay. So this is a movie about a dyslexic kid who is unconventionally taught, and a new potential out of the kid is created or emerged in the whole movie. That's how the movie actually works. In this movie, there is a lot of unlearning of who Aamir Khan was as a teacher had to happen first. And he had to overwrite based on what he is learning from the kid called Ishan. Okay. Now what happened for Aamir in that movie was, he started understanding a few things about the kid. The kid is unique. That's the first, he cannot consider every kid to be the same. So the uniqueness is something that he had to create. There is always a root cause to something that has actually created what's really happened with that kid. He was able to see a passion in the kid which created happiness for him. Okay. And then Amir Khan had to break conventional methods of education for him to create a new style of approach with the kid so that he can bring the best of the potential out. Okay? And every time he wanted to provide an advice to the kid, he could not, because he automatically saw that just him being around with him created the best potential out of him. And that's why it is called no message is a message. He never gave any message, and that itself became a message. So if you guys have not seen this movie, I would love for you to actually see this movie and see how that whole transformation actually happens for the kid. How he starts realizing certain things about himself, where Amir was just being around as a teacher. In fact, he used the kid to make a big difference to the environment of the school itself. That's what he actually does. But the concept of unlearning and overwriting is done by him. While this is from an Indian concept, you know, context altogether, look at a very international context. This is the second movie. I'm sure all of you would be aware or at least seen Kung Fu Panda. Right? By any chance, anybody not seen it? I'd love for you to see this. But what really, you know, got to me was the concept of the panda was the same. The panda was unique. There was a root cause to what he was. His passion for Kung Fu was giving him the maximum happiness. And if you're familiar with the characters, there is a character called Shifu, who is his master. Shifu had to completely unlearn and overwrite everything that he knew about Kung Fu and everything that he knew about a character called the Dragon Warrior, which is what the panda becomes in the movie. Okay, so that he can make a difference where the panda realizes his own potential. Now, the best part is, even in that movie, they talk about a scroll, which is like the most powerful scroll ever. And he goes to find that. And when he actually gets the scroll, he looks inside and there is absolutely nothing in the scroll. Right? Which is exactly the same thing about no message is a message. Seeing nothing is where the whole everything is possible. And that's the unlearning and overwriting that even the panda had to do for him to become the Dragon Warrior. That he could realize that there is something new that could come out of him. So that concept of unlearning and overwriting coming out very clearly in these movies was a big concept for me. What I want you to see, take away is, you are Shifu in some place, you are Panda in some place. You are Amir Khan in some place, and you are Ishan in some place. If you can relate to that, that will create the process of unlearning and overwriting for all of you. That's what I wanted to leave you, and that's why it is why you. The why you is, you play all these roles at different times. But here is where you have an opportunity to unlearn and overwrite. At every time. Just to share it more from a perspective of the, you know, a more visual experience through a movie. Fair enough? I quickly saw a chat coming in. Okay, moving on. Okay, so here is a technique that I have with respect to how you can constantly change. While, yes, so what is the way you actually see it as a process. Okay, but here is one technique which I wanted to share, you know, which really creates the constant space for you to unlearn. Okay, a very simple concept called T. And T is actually, T is you, okay? It is you as a person. On top of you is now, the present, the moment, the present moment, okay? and below you is I am. Okay, this is a technique. The technique is T, top of you is now, and below you is I am, which is you. Okay. So how does this technique work? I'm going to explain that. Now is being in the present, being in the moment. You realize that there is a need for change at this moment. So whenever you feel that you are wanting to unlearn, you have to first become aware that there is a need for me to change at this time. When Mejan went through the process of people honking at him and feeling that annoying stage, he has to come to the now for him to realize that there is a need for change for him. Okay. And that's the now. The second is I. I is the intention in the I am. Intention. Once the need has been identified, you create the intention to make the change. It could be by thought or by action, but constantly be in the intention. Okay. A is the action. From the intention comes the action, where here you may want to act immediately or you may get to the point of being ready to act, but whichever it is, but you take the necessary action in the A. Okay. And M is modify. This is the state where you take the action and modify your behavior from here on with respect to that particular behavior. So now I am. Keep that constantly alive for yourself. You have an opportunity to create a space for unlearning and overwriting at all times. Okay. Now, relating it just to the concept of you guys doing coaching with another person. There is a lot of times of your own values and your own thoughts and your own understanding, which keeps coming constantly at that particular moment. Right? So coaching is a space where you are constantly in the now. You have to be in the present to know that, are you thinking something else other than your client is what is actually sharing with you. So the need for change is very important. So you realize the need for change that, yes, I am thinking something else. I need to come back. And then your intention is to be available for the client, to be open, to be listening, to be, completely available. I would like to remove word client here. Sorry for me using that, because it need not be the client. It could be with anyone. And as I said, it's not just being a coach. It's about every single role that you actually play. A father to a son or a mother to a daughter, right? You will have to be present to see what intention you have at that particular moment and take the action to modify. That would be a very important space of constantly doing an unlearning and overwriting at every stage. So this is one concept that I thought of when it came to unlearning and overwriting and the concept of T. Okay. Any questions? Anything coming up? Anything to share? I saw a chat coming in. Okay. So now I'll come back to one question, the past. How many of you recall the three things that you learned about the unlearning process from slide one? Answer without looking into your notes. The first slide that you saw for 1 minute. If you want to just type it out or you want to say it, I'm okay. But do you remember?
I remember something about empowerment being the last point on the U.
Okay.
And discomfort with the process initially.
Sure. Okay. So, Poonam also says she has two, she is able to remember them. the two things that she actually wrote, but not most of you were actually able to recall, right? So I had given that. So I'll ask this question. How many of you can recall the T now? The concept of T. Yes, no, share or chat or word is.
I don't.
Okay. You're not able to recall the T?
Yeah, no, I can't recall.
Okay. That's fine. The idea behind this is, I was trying to see if you were able to recall the three things that I actually said. That was the unlearning process before. And right now I have provided you with a technique which I felt that I use, right? And I just wanted to say that you just unlearned a false process of unlearning and overwritten over T. Basically, what I meant to say is the process that I showed earlier, it was not the unlearning process at all. It has nothing to do with unlearning. It was just a slide which talked about reality to reality. That's it. Right? But that was a false process. But here is something that you have learned at this particular point of time, where in this whole conversation today, at this particular moment, you have been able to apply a T where you have unlearned the false process. That's the experience I wanted to leave you at this particular slide. And T is also thank you. That's it. So I'm done. Any questions, anything that's coming up, you can share before over to Rajat, before it goes to Rajat. Any thoughts?
Hi, Arvind. Yes, one thing which I liked, you know, you took which upsets or annoyances, right? That's a beautiful learning today, which I've learned, right? You'd have taken anything, but when you've taken the feeling of, you know, if you meant putting us, think as even Masjan said, yes, it's a very good learning. Thank you.
Sure. Thanks, Kopi. Thank you.
Arvind, can you stop the share so that
yes.
You can see everybody?
Sure.
Arvind, I've not read the books by Alvin Toffler, but
okay.
The quote is a quote that I've known of for a very long time, and I find it very interesting because I've seen it play out in organizations.
Right.
You know, in the form of behaviors, stroke performance, stroke, you know, the general lifetime of professionals within an organization. And I've seen it from different angles. So this quote has always made a lot of sense. But this, the way you explained whole thing, I think it was beautiful. It was very simple, and it drove home the point. So it was more about seeing that in action, but now understanding this in a certain structure. So thank you for
that. Sure. Thanks, Poonam. Thank you.
So it seems Rupa, the only thing that Rupa loved was your smiley.
Takeaway is different forms.
Can we see everybody now? It's okay to see you guys. Can it come? Yes, thank you. George, Chachi, Abhilasha, Sharmi, Sushanta, I'm hoping you are in a decent place now. And
He's just smiling away.
Yeah, I haven't been able to do anything but listen and watch the slides.
Okay, good. So, who dropped off?
I didn't understand what Abhilasha said, except that I'm unlearning everything you shared. Okay.
Very insightful that I'm unlearning everything you shared. Okay. Any questions? Any last minute thoughts, feelings? Yeah, so, sorry. Yeah, Misha.
Rajat and Arvind, right? I mean, I certainly got the concept and it's very powerful. I think I'll tell you the thing that I personally struggle with, right? Like in that same honking, right?
Okay.
He's like, I know all this technically. I know I should not react. I know I shouldn't. but you know, when you lose it in that moment, you just lose it, right? I mean, there is no thinking at that time. I cannot think.
Sure.
I cannot think about so what. I mean, I'm, you know, when the honking is out of control, I am also out of control and I cannot think. So I'm just trying to say, you know, it's that emotional part which is so hard to bring under control in that moment, right? You said the T and the now and, you know, stopping and saying, okay, I got to stop and think, so what? It doesn't matter that this guy is honking, right?
Right.
So I'm just saying, you know, if you'll have any ideas about what has worked for you all, you know, in terms of how do you get yourself to think right at that moment when there is such a wave of emotion and anger or whatever you call it, right?
So this whole concept of this, you know, the anger and this wave that comes over to you, Vishan, is coming from a particular knowledge and a learning that you have had till now in your life, isn't it?
Yeah.
You hate it, right? So if there's a reason for that irritation that is caused by somebody honking at you and all the kind of stuff, what happens if you were to unlearn this whole stuff completely and say, I don't even understand what honking is?
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And what judgment do you associate with honking?
Yeah, you're right. I mean, there is certainly, you know, my interpretation of what that honking means, right? If you really wanted to give benefit of the doubt, and sometimes I think to myself, yeah.
So I'm saying forget all that you're, there is a benefit, there is a doubt. I'm saying there's nothing associated with that honking for you. If you just to disassociate everything that is there for honking with you, that honking is for alerting others also, just take away that knowledge.
Mm. Yeah.
And then come and figure out saying, why, you know, is this honking? If this is honking, what's making that person honk? I don't know. Mm. Not sure, Arvind, if I'm doing the right thing, but just going by the flow.
Yes, Rajat.
Yeah.
That's a very interesting perspective, by the way. That's even more deep than what I was kind of talking. What if we don't know what honking is? Very interesting.
Yeah.
Mijan is not there. He's just saying, yeah.
No, I'm saying, I get it in concept. You know, I really get it that I should not associate. So my current association is this is extremely rude, disrespectful behavior from somebody behind me, right? That is my current association in my brain. I totally get that. Now, given that my brain is wired like that for how many ever years put together, breaking that wiring is significant effort, like you're saying, right? If I have to start suddenly saying, you know, honking means nothing. Honking doesn't mean he or she is being rude. It doesn't mean, you know, that they're being disrespectful. Yeah, I mean, I understand. And it's certainly worth a try. I mean, but yeah, it's a deeper association that creates the problem.
Yeah. So it's all those associations, right, that create the problem in all our lives.
Correct.
Mm.
Specifically with respect to honking, I'd like to share an incident.
Yeah. Okay.
Yeah.
Let's go.
So, like, I mean, just like Mason said, you know, I used to see it honking with the guy behind me is abusing me for not moving forward. Hmm. And while I was in Chennai, I was traveling to Pondicherry in a car and had a driver who would honk every 5 to 10 seconds. So while we were in the city, I presumed, you know, he's trying to, you know, honk at the traffic ahead of him. But once he got on the, you know, Maraimalainagar highway, Tindivanam highway, the road, it was early in the morning, 6:30, and road absolutely clear, and he was still honking. So after about 15 minutes, I asked him, nobody on the road, whom are you honking at? Uh-huh. And then he had a very surprised look on his face. And he said, sir, actually, you know, while you're holding the steering, driving in the city, I'm so used to it that every time my hand comes around, it goes two times. And I just honk out of habit. And it was a, you know, big realization for me that the guy maybe not even honking at me, maybe honking purely by experience. And it happened once again when I actually stopped, got out of my car, it was a block and the guy was honking. I went back to him and I asked, why are you honking? What am I supposed to do? And he literally took his hand off the wheel and he said, I didn't realize I was honking. So I think in India, especially, people are conditioned that way. So like Rajat said, if you disassociate with honking itself, we'll probably not lose our cool.
No, thanks. That sounds like a great example based on really what a couple of drivers told you. Huh? That's opens my mind to, it could really not be what I'm thinking.
And Mishan, this happens only in Pondicherry. Yeah? He's also talking Pondicherry.
Yeah. It is interesting that he picked roughly the same city.
Rajat, may I just make
up one observation? When Arvind asked us to list like the three things that annoyed us, right? I listed them and I realized that they were all three that I had talked about in my own peer coaching sessions when I was the coachee. And for me, there was a eureka moment. Like Arvind, for example, I don't know if you remember, but I used to keep saying that I used to feel like a burning in my throat with the stress and the anxiety.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, it was there and then one day it just wasn't there, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And mm-hmm. I give full credit to the coaching process for that. And that's one thing. And two is one aphorism that I always live by is never assume malice for something that can just as easily be explained by idiocy. So that has sort of helped me on many, many occasions. I just thought I'd share that, particularly with the honking.
Sure. Yeah. So I agree to that, Sandhya, but I still don't know this is malice or what. You're not inviting Arvind to your wedding, so.
When I do invite, you don't show up. Just for the record, everybody. Yes. I just wrote a heartfelt love note about I missed all of you because you ditched my party that I did invite you for.
Sandhya, from one small request, please say malice.
Why?
Because I don't want it to be the other one in that sentence of yours.
Yes, this is with malice a forethought. To be precise.
Yeah. Thank you.
Okay, tell Nav to go put face pack on.
Okay. Yeah. Good. Thank sure. you. Any last words?
Thank you, guys. Thank you so much. Anything? So let me know. This is an open discussion on this topic, guys. I happened to just stumble upon this when I started doing. I would like to learn a lot more on unlearning and overwriting. And if there are discussions that you would like to kind of do, please let me know and we can definitely connect on that.
Sure. More thank you, Arvind. Thank you so much. And thank you, everybody, for joining in. Good to see you guys.
Okay.
Thanks, Arvind.
And we have, I think, Arvind, next one is from Monica, right? Or Alistair?
Alistair.
Okay. So very interesting topic coming up next from a UK-based coach. And he's into mind tools and all that kind of stuff. So let me not break it as of now, but very, very interesting coming up. Next one.
Right.
Okay.
You will hear from us soon.
Yes.
Thank you, guys. Thank you.
Bye, guys. Bye-bye. Take care. Happy wedding, Sandhya. Take care.
Thank you.
Bye-bye.